my pleasure to introduce the artist, educator, and advocate for artists, Sharon Loudon. A few things about Sharon. She holds a BFA in Studio Art from the Art Institute of Chicago and an MFA from Yale University School of Art. She's shown widely, numerous venues, including the Aldrich Contemporary, the Drawing Center, Carnegie Mellon University, Wiseman Art Museum, Kemper Museum of Art, the National Gallery of Art, and many others. Her work is held in major public and private collections, such as the Whitney Museum of American Art, the National Gallery of Art, Neuberger Museum of Art, the Museum of Fine Arts Houston, Yale University Art Gallery, and also, again, other venues as well. Writing about her work has been included and been published in many magazines and periodicals, including New York Times, Art in America, Sculpture Magazine, Art News, the Philadelphia Inquirer. She's a faculty member in the MFA Fine Arts Program at the School of Visual Arts in New York, as well as a senior critic at the New York Academy of Art. In addition to teaching in colleges and universities, she continues to conduct GLOWTOWN workshops in schools and not-for-profit organizations across the country. Loudon is active on boards and committees of various not-for-profit art organizations and volunteers her time to artists to further their careers. Sharon is a consultant for the Joan Mitchell Foundation and the Emily Hall Tremaine Foundation, as well as contributes to various organizations, including the National Endowment for the Arts. She's a member of the Artist Advisory Boards of the New York Foundation for the Arts, NYFA, and the Carolyn Glazo Bailey Foundation. She's a member of the board of directors of the Elizabeth Foundation for the Arts. She's also the editor of two books on the subject of artists in the creative world. Published by Intellect Books, Living and Sustaining a Creative Life, Essays by 40 Working Artists, published in 2013. It's on its seventh edition, it's had seven printings. Mm-hmm. So, also, The Artist as Cultural Producer, Living and Sustaining a Creative Life, published in 2017. That's on its second printing and has also been endorsed by the Ford Foundation in order so that symposium can be organized for communities and groups who might not otherwise have access to this information. The last book in the trilogy, Living and Sustaining a Creative Life, The Last Artist Standing, will be published in 2020. Currently, she's the recipient of the Sharp-Fuente Studio Program 2017-18 Award, which is a year-long rent-free studio space in Dumbo, Brooklyn, which began in 2017. And works that she's working on in relationship to that residency can be seen on her site.
Thank you.
As well, so check that out. We're going to have a quick talk, what I hope to be an interesting long talk. And also, afterwards, we'll have book signing. Books are available for purchase, cash or check. So please stay around after the talk and have a moment to talk with the artist and pick up a book. So please join me in welcoming Sharon Loudon to Ohio University.
Nice to meet you too. Hi everybody. How are you feeling?
Great.
Good.
Good. It's nice to meet all of you. This will be quick, but I think we're gonna have some time for conversation, right?
Mm-hmm.
So I think talks are really boring a lot of times. So I'm not gonna make this boring. I'm just gonna fly through this. But also, I would love some engagement if you have questions. The reason why I have all that contact information up there is that I also love engagement on the web, so on the internet. So if you want to tag Live Sustain, because this is actually part of a big conversation tour, me being here, that then connects that hashtag Live Sustain connects to a lot of other people who have chimed in on this, and I'm going to talk about that. But Tim was so kind to mention all of these things that I've done. I'm very very grateful to be here, that Courtney has brought me here. Thank you so much. So I do a couple books, as I mentioned. They're here today. I'm going to talk about that. And a lot of people think, just because I've done some books, that I'm an author and not an artist. I'm an artist. So I'm just going to prove to you a little bit that I'm an artist. So I'm just going to show some examples really quickly, some examples of what I've done. So I'm going to try this. Oh, good, it works. So for me, as an artist, I graduated, as Tim said, from Yale University. I graduated with $115,000 in debt in 1991. I paid those, that's equivalent of $206,000 today. I paid those debts off in 10 years as an artist. I'm married to a jazz musician who we both work together. He's actually my project manager. And I'm estranged from my family. And that's a lot of TMI, but it just gives you a context that I pretty much have done everything myself, and I'm really proud of that, because that was one of the reasons why I did these books too, is that you can sustain a creative life as an artist. So I work in all different media. I don't believe that media dictates who I am as an artist. Like, I'm not a painter, I'm not a sculptor, I'm not an animator, I'm not a public art artist, I'm just an artist. But most of the work I do, and what I'm doing at the Sharp Valentis program right now, is sculpture. So I'm just going to go through these big sculptures and use them also as an example to show, too, how artists can be activists in their own community and make change by just the projects that they do, that they receive and that they do. So I oftentimes work in one idea for many years. My work has to do with these. I used to be a figurative painter, and then over the years, I broke those lines down of figures into these anthropomorphic forms that then, when they're put together, to me, I like to see them of nature, but not of nature, and not literally of nature, but implied nature, that creates inclusive environments for interactivity. So this is a reflective roofing material that I found at Home Depot, and a lot of the work that I do, too, is based on collaborations with curators. 80% of the things that I have received in my life, exhibition opportunities, galleries, working with galleries, are from cold calls. Not literally picking up the phone, I would never advise you to do that, but developing relationships with people. And I never see an exhibition as a thing to get. I never see it as an end game. I see it just as a marker and experience in my life with that person. So this, in fact, is with Mary Murray at Bunsen Williams Proctor Institute, which is actually a beautiful museum in Utica, New York. And she and I developed a relationship, and my drawings are in their collection. And she said, what if you wanted to do an exhibition here? And I said, great, I found this material. She said, go to town. So this started out as these little forms, like I said, and creating this sort of environment of these forms. I love beauty too. I think beauty's underrated. I'm not afraid of it. And I love reflective material that implies some movement. So from that, then 6 years later, I found another space, sort of like another canvas. And I wanted to then move that idea into this. I did grow the idea into Project 4 in Washington, D.C. And then they started to multiply, and then in 2011, I blew it out, because it really based on the fact that I had this great relationship with this curator. And I feel like within these collaborations with curators, they have a vision, I have a vision. They never infringe on my vision, but when we work together, if it's good connection, I'll just breathe and flow freely. So this is a piece that's 350,000 strips of aluminum, 20,000 screws, and 20 pounds of glue. It's only about 3,000 square feet. But the idea was to create this environment that had that inclusivity, by which it includes people through when they can see themselves in the aluminum, as well as a feeling of nature. And then transforming an environment to something I would think is more friendly, beautiful, and has light as an interactive component. So this was done too at the Weissman Art Museum in Minnesota, where the outside of the museum is made by Frank Gehry, who I actually knew him in college at Yale, and He was teaching architecture at the time. I thought that was so interesting. It's very interesting. I'm 53 years old and grateful to be this age because I realized that the best part of, is this on, by the way? Can you hear me?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, so I don't need this. I'm loud and clear, very loud. So you don't need, you don't need a microphone, right, for me?
That's right.
Great. So anyway, the thing I learned is that, you know, our community is really small, and oftentimes I circle back to people that I've met in one form or another. So I thought it was ironic that I met him years later, and just a story, he was really cranky and not very pleasant to be with, but nonetheless, Frank Gehry, but nonetheless, I have a great deal of respect for him, and I loved the idea that he had, that I was actually creating a dialogue with the outside of the museum, which was his first museum commission. That was expanded at the time that I did this piece. This is a temporary installation. I'm just going to talk money too, because I think it's really important for artists not to be afraid of talking about money and being open. This was a, I think it was like a $180,000 budget. Whenever I get a budget for a museum exhibition, I always try to pay people more than a living wage to work with me. I believe as artists, we are small business people, especially if you have any transactions in money, so I usually pay people, in this case they were paid $25 an hour. These are just the students from University of Minnesota, but the average for me is $35 to $50 an hour for each artist, plus all of their expenses, including a per diem for food every day. I really believe that we have to live sustainably, and the one way that we can do that as artists, when you have an opportunity, share the opportunity. So that's why the budgets are very high, or else I don't do them, essentially. And this was a temporary installation, and then the work of the museum also bought some of my work for the museum itself, a different piece. So anyway, the way that this piece worked was I would set up these, what I call drawing in space, these little drawings, and then these University of Minnesota students would come in and then put these together. And Nina right over there in the turquoise blue shirt, I just saw her last week. We have a friendship. We stayed in touch all these years. And then Erin, who's in the floral dress, I flew her in to do another project. So I sort of see it as like all of my relationships is just the start of something else and a shared experience. Another thing I love to do is make exhibitions transparent as a way of also loosening up and making things accessible. I don't think the art world is, I think the art world's too opaque. So this was for an exhibition at the Asheville Art Museum, and the material I use, it's highly reflective aluminum, so you can see yourself in it. So there's a lot of bling in it, and people love it for selfies. So I said, okay, I put a panel up, right? The museum put a panel and said, if you want to take a selfie, tag me and we'll have a relationship. So for 2 years, well, not a relationship, but for 2 years, I had a good run of having conversation with people on Instagram, maybe 10 to 25 people a week, which was really fun. And people had a good time. And somebody actually got married in my piece too, which was hilarious. Another project is my project sort of evolved from one piece to the next, and they just a sort of a linear progression. Again, this highly reflective aluminum, you can't buy it in this country. It's actually very rare. It's a raw aluminum. That's my husband in the corner. He's also a model for me. So he's in the corner. This is actually a fairly small space at 3,000 square feet, and the 33-foot ceilings, and I felt like the environment was really not very attractive, and I wanted to be able to include people more, so that's what we did. I lowered the aluminum enough that people saw themselves in it, and it created this motion and broke up the architecture, and as people walked through, they would not only see themselves, but all the colors on their body would reflect. So that's a little bit about my work, and there's a ton of other stuff on my website that you can see. But I'm here today to talk about living and sustaining creative life. So as an artist, I do today, artists wear all multiple hats. And Even though I have that sharp lens studio right now, I'm making big sculptures. I'm actually collaborating with different people. It's sort of like a lab or experimental space for me while I do all of this stuff. So there's no difference for me. In 2009, I moderated a panel at the College Art Association Conference. Has anybody ever heard of that organization?
Mm-hmm.
CAA, collegeart.org. And the panel was called How to Make a Living With or Without a Dealer. And 400 people showed up in the audience, standing room only. I was like, you know, it's really good that you're here and it really sucks that you're here, because it means that you're dependent on the system, that you're dying to know how to sustain a creative life with a dealer. And I was really troubled by that. And you never know who's in the audience. So my publisher was in the audience. So Intellect and University of Chicago Press are the people I work with, and Yale University Press. And one of those representatives was in the audience, and they said, we really want you to write a book. I said, I can't even write an artist statement. I'm not going to write a book. I mean, artist statements are like terrible. Is anybody having trouble with those in school? Well, I'm with you, like, a lot. I feel you. So it was very funny. Nobody's recording this, right? Okay, so I can say this, because my husband heard this again, he'd probably kill me, but I love my husband. I've been married to him a long time. But basically, I get home and I say, oh, Vince, that's my husband's name, I have an offer to write a book. He goes, you're not going to write a book. It's ridiculous. And I was like, oh, yeah, now I'm going to write a book. So I was like, forget it. If you ever say no to me, I'll totally ram it. And thank God, I say to him every day, isn't it great that we did this? So it's awesome. It's sort of spiteful in a way. But anyway, so when my publisher said to me, they said, well, what would you want to do if you don't want to write a book? I said, you know, I want to share this, but I want to have a book on the shelves to make our community more transparent. How do artists sustain a creative life? Why doesn't anybody talk about that? Also, why can't we define ourselves to ourselves, but also to the public as to who we really are? Because Van Gogh died in 1890. Sorry if that offends anybody or hurts you to hear that he actually did die in 1890, and along with so many other, you know, white guys in art history. Art history has to be decolonized. I feel like there has to be a change, and the change has to come from us and the public. So I thought, how about if I ask 40 people I know to just start a conversation about how to sustain a creative life? So what happened was, with this book was, we edited this book. I mean, it was amazing that this even happened. Even when I see this, I cannot believe that we did this. And I picked 40 people, 19 people from New York, 19 people from the rest of the country, 2 people from Europe, 21 women, 19 men. All of my books will always, sorry for the men, but all of my books will always have more women than men. And so I did this, and I thought, okay, what am I going to do with this? I thought it was just going to go on a shelf. So in Christmas night 2013, the book had just come out in October. It already sold out twice. I couldn't believe it. The first one sold out before it got on the shelves, just by internet. I couldn't believe it. I was like, why? And I know why, because so many people don't know this. And in schools, people don't talk about this. Not enough. So, and I teach professional development. I knew that, but not to the extent that it did. That was needed. I had a house fire in my house in Bay Ridge in Brooklyn. And the next day after Christmas, we had put all of our stuff in storage, and we were in a car, and we had no idea what to do. So I said, Vince, you know, I just started this little tour, and I didn't even know what it was, because publishers don't set up the tours. I set up my tours. So we said, why don't we just call a bunch of friends, because I have friends who are museums and galleries, et cetera, because I don't believe there are any divisions in the art world. Museum directors, to me, is the same as an artist. I see no difference. So I started calling them, and I said, you know, I have this book, and it seems you're doing really well. Do you want us to come to you? So we were homeless for 229 days and did 62 stops on a book tour. And that's why it's in its seventh printing and sold in 18 countries and adopted by schools all over the world, which I'm really grateful for, because it means that maybe we can change the public's view of who we are, but also empower ourselves to do things for ourselves. So anyway, like I said, this thing went on a massive crazy tour, and these are book selfies in different bookstores. And I had no idea that this would form this way, so what I decided to do was like moderated conversations that would warm up an audience, and then I would ask the audience to talk about what do artists need and what do they want. I'm going to ask all of you that today, so I'm warming you up today. What do you need and what do you want? If you don't know what you need, you sure as hell know what you want, right? So that was at the Hirshhorn. We had over 200 people there. The Strand is the only bookstore I'll ever go to for my books because it, when I was really poor with all that debt, the Strand would buy back my books so I'd have another week of eating. And then that was up there at the Hirshhorn. And what I would do is cross-pollinate artists together, and I'm doing this right now where if I'm not speaking by myself, I'm speaking with other artists where I'm bringing local artists with contributors in the book, and then that kind of validation then shows other people can also connect far and wide. So yeah, it just went like bananas. We were on radio, we went to all different places, went to small regional places, then went to like LACMA in Los Angeles, all different places. I felt like I was in this truck all the time. Doesn't that guy look like a serial killer? He's one of my contributors from my first book as Blaine. Look, afterwards, this is at Indiana University. I felt like he was going to say, I'm going to kill you. but he's a good friend. And then that was at Art Basel. That was a big controversial discussion. You never know what people say in the audience, especially when artists talk to other artists, because then we have a safe space to talk. Okay, so here are the stats for that tour, which I think are important. This is all where we went. The number of attendees, over 5,000 people. We live tweet a lot of the events. Total, what we raised and spent was started from a Kickstarter campaign, and that's what just got it going. And we were literally on the road for all that time, and I learned a lot on that tour. And what I learned was that there's a lot of misconceptions from the public about who we are. That's not surprising, but also artists was interesting. So when my publisher said to me, do you want to do a second book? I was like, yeah, and I want to make this a sustainable project because the first one really wasn't sustainable. I was in the red a lot. So what I do for my books is I split the royalties with all the artists because I feel like the publishing industry is really antiquated and far older than the art world, right? They have big problems because most anthologies, the income that comes from it, the profit, usually just goes to the editor. But that doesn't make any sense because the contributors all write the book. So, of course, I organize it as an editor. I do all the tours. I pick people. I select everything. They write the essay, but they're the source of that content. And they also, to be able to share their lives, takes a lot of courage. So for that last book and this book, the royalties are split 44 ways and 45 ways. I just got my royalty check for this book for the first year. It's annual checks. And then I give everybody in my contract their own copyright, which is also unusual. So the idea is, the point is as an artist, we have leverage. We can think in advance to contribute to contracts and any kind of contract. And if we think in advance about what we want to make more of a movement towards our community, we can do that. So for this book, the last tour, when I asked the public or introduced somebody, an artist on, let's say, on the tour, and say, this is an artist, and I could just see the public sort of glaze over, like looking at me like, oh, this is a failed person, somebody who doesn't take a shower, who can't speak and select, you know, like I'm struggling with completed sentences, or lazy. And that's wrong. All three of those things are wrong. We're some of the hardest working people. As artists, we bounce back from failure like no other field. We also start things from nothing in our studio. I don't know why we can't apply that outside our studios. There seems to be a disconnect there. And then we also have a cabal that's really open. You say you're an artist, we can walk in, and there's an acceptability that's like no other field. So I knew all this, and then also the other side, artists would say to me on this tour, they're saying, you can't do everything else, like wear multiple hats and have a gallery. I was like, what? So for this book, I picked people who have a leg in the art world, and then they create bridges to the public. So, the royalties from my first book, look at our checks. We're not making a lot of money. $10.04 a person for the first year, or for the first check. I was still in New York then, and what did I get with that? I think I got like a breakfast that morning at Dunkin' Donuts or something. But I celebrated each one of them. But the point is, it's not the amount of money. The point is to try to enact that to make a difference. This book tour, this is the 81st stop out of 100 right now. I've done 80 stops before this, starting in March 2nd, all over the place, including the UK and Australia. I'm going to Alaska in April. I'm going to New Orleans. I'm going to all different places, all small and large communities. This book tour is fully sustainable. We made Living and Sustaining Creative Life a fiscally sponsored entity, which means that I'm not a nonprofit. I'm still a sole prop, and I'm a freelance. I'm still a singular artist, but work with the New York Foundation for the Arts for them to take in money as an organization so I can get grants, etc. We've gotten a lot of funding, and I'm going to talk about that too. I'm also making my time here, like, this is not being recorded today, or is it? Is it being recorded? Mm-hmm. Awesome. Can I have a copy of that recording?
Absolutely.
Perfect. So that will become a part of the data that goes into this conversation tour, and I just got a grant, a matching grant, to take the data and make it into exhibitions, publications, and make it widely distributed all over the world, online as well. We already have a source for it to be online, which is really exciting. What does that mean? It means that your needs and wants are going to go onto that recording, and then we get to share that with the world. And then show what we can, I mean, it shows who we are, but also it helps like organizations like the Ford Foundation to be able to know who we are enough to fill those needs. And I think that's really important. Am I doing okay on time?
You're fine.
Okay, so I want to share a story with you. So as I said, 80% of the things I've gotten are from cold calls. So has anybody ever heard of this organization?
Yes.
You have? I didn't really hear of it before. I thought it was the Ford Motor Company, of which it was, initially started that, from that family. But I didn't know really what it was or the mechanics of it. Thank God I didn't. Because I had heard Darren Walker, who's the executive director of the Ford Foundation, on the radio. And I sort of fell in love with him. Have you ever done that? Like you look on television and there's an actor or something that you fall in love with or you're dreaming of or you're hearing somebody on radio, and I immediately fell in love with him, and I was like, oh my God, he's breathing my language. So I said, I have to meet him, and I want him on my tour. So I started asking all these nonprofit organizations I work for, which I'll show in a minute, and the nonprofit organizations, they all said, we can't give you his email address. I was like, why not? And they said, because they're funding us. And I was like, oh, that's okay, because I'm going to get that email address, and then I'm going to cold call him. So I did. I took somebody out to lunch and finally got his email address. I sent him a cold call email, didn't hear from him for 2 weeks, and then found his executive secretary's assistant's address. Got a meeting with him. Half hour. He said, put together a document that has 3 points that, and two, no longer, no older, more than 2 pages, that describes how you want to work together. I said, great. And you know what I learned? I don't know if you know or if you agree with this, but in my lifetime, momentum is precious. So I didn't let it sit. So the very next day, I canceled all of my meetings and I spent work on this document. The very next day, I sent, that night actually, so it was more than 24 hours, maybe a couple more hours after, I sent him this document and he wrote me right back 15 minutes later saying, not only will we endorse you, we're going to give you $50,000 to go to marginalized communities all over the world. So that's what can happen when there's the right fit, when you find a right fit and you can connect with somebody that you really believe in and that you have something that you really believe in, and now they're my partners. So the other people I partner with, as Tim said, EFA, Joe Mitchell Foundation, I'm on the founding advisory board of the New York Academy of Art, and then has anybody ever heard of WAGE? You should definitely take a screenshot of this if you don't know this. Every artist should know WAGE. What's great about Wage, it was started by Lise, who's an artist who basically it helps artists structure a fee so that you can ask for money to be paid. And oftentimes we don't know where to start when we ask to be paid, and this website does that. Did everybody take a screenshot? Okay, can I move on? Okay, I work with them. And then NYFA, my facilitating sponsor at Chautauqua School of Art, USA, Tremaine. So Tremaine, as a consultant, I work with them on this website. And I would take a screenshot of this as well. This is a new website called Artists Thrive. And what it is, it's a rubric for professional development that's free. It's actually an organic website. They're still adding to it. We're working on it a lot to be able to bring a lot of information from different artists to help different artists. Everybody got that? Okay, so now I'm going to wrap this up with the tour. Don't those guys look like mountain men? Like, look at the ceiling, right? They look like they just haven't taken a shower, right? Just like what the public thinks. But they're not. These two are contributors to my book. They took a shower for this shot. I'm pretty sure they did. So this is Steve and Khaled. And the best part about doing these projects, too, is that half the people in this book, the artist, culture producer, half the people in this book I didn't know before I started this. I did a lot of vetting, but I didn't know them. And a lot of contributors didn't know each other. So these two never met before. And so I got them together. Steve was in Australia, and now these two are going to collaborate, which is so great. The power and cabal of artists together. So has anybody ever heard of hyperallergic? Mm-hmm. Who knows hyperallergic? Okay, all of you who don't, I can spell it out for you. I guess I should have typed it on it. Hyper and then allergic, all in one word. Anyway, this guy is my closest friend in the world. Robert, pause for more than 3 seconds. I say I can't talk to you. So I feel like our cabal has to be supported with one another, and when that happens, we grow a lot with or without a dealer as part of the ecosystem. So Edgar is an amazing artist who does drawings. He won the Performer Prize in 2015. He is shows at Suzanne Bell Metter Gallery in Los Angeles. He teaches at USC, and he started this non-for-profit organization with Rick Lowe called the Watts House Project. It didn't last very long, but the point is he started something that was beautifying his community. So artists can do a lot. Sharon Butler, has anybody ever heard of Two Coats of Paint? You should totally take a screenshot of this too. She's super generous. I don't know if you know this, but she has a studio in Dumbo, which is where the Sharp Studios are too. It's in Brooklyn, and what she does is she has a residency for artists about 3 or 4 times a year. She gives her studio over 1 week during that time, 3 or 4 times a year, to an artist from out of town, not in New York, and then she'll give over her whole studio to them, put them on her blog, show up at the opening reception of a showcase. She asks them to do that and participates with them, which is super generous. She also started a $50 stock club, where she said, you know, I need to make some money. Who wants to come in with me? Sort of against the rules of trading. Who cares? She did that, and people came in together. Everybody who saw on her blog that she was doing this came in together, pulled together, and they made money for a year. But it didn't take that much. That's her. She also, I would recommend her coming here, too. She's fantastic. She's also very even, so she's good for my blood pressure. These two, so Zoe was the one who introduced me to Courtney. So Zoe and Tim, Zoe is the cover of this book, is the cover. This is her work. She's beautiful. She's one of my best friends. She is incredible. These two are collaborators. They were hired at American University, and they talk about this in the essay, where they did an essay together, as a diversity hire. And knowing that they were, they said, you know what, we're going to make a pact, and we're going to change this place. And we're going to work together. For 14 years, they got into pedagogy at American University, turned it over, created partnerships, museums, all over the Washington, D.C., Baltimore area, and then also started a project space called Syndicate, where they've gotten grants to sponsor experimental projects by artists. All these people are accessible. So the tour's been amazing. So there's Edgar, Zoe, and Tim. It's been fun and exciting and motivating. It's also been, this was a 5-hour, 4-sponsored dinner that we all made. We made spaghetti and salad. Of course, had bourbon. That's my favorite drink. Whiskey at every table. And then we all talked about what we needed and wanted. 100 artists in Baltimore in the middle of the unrest there. We also went to Spaces Gallery in Cleveland, where somebody in the audience said, why don't museums come to my neighborhood? And then somebody from MoCA Cleveland was in the audience and they talked about it. At the Walker, we talked about women of color and how important it is for women and people of color to have more opportunities and to raise the bar. And that's a big advocacy for me and all the work I do. And then I went to all the 21 Scene Museum hotels, which are these hotels that are basically collections by one couple in different regions all over the country. I was in Kentucky, actually Lexington and Louisville, and then I went to Cincinnati in August. And then at these, this was Cincinnati in August, at this talk, sometimes I hand out blank cards because if I see young people in the audience that have their deers in headlights, basically, which I don't feel from all of you. I feel like you'll be able to ask questions. But sometimes they're really young, and so I hand out these sheets of paper, and they ask questions anonymously. So I'm going to share a few of them as I wrap this up. What makes you feel most vulnerable as an artist? And we would answer them. I'm sorry, there's a cuss word in that one. This is at Maine College of Art and Design. How can I cultivate a source of confidence in myself on a day-to-day basis? In today's political climate, how can one person or group of persons make an impactful statement without coming across negatively or as a bleep? Through graphic design as an art form, I often ask myself and have the conversation with those around me, through art, what can we do? And we should be asking ourselves that question. You all should be asking yourself that question. Another one, so painful to read this, but we answered it at Pratt Institute in September. How do you create generosity when no one around you is reciprocating it? It's hard. How, when you first start as an artist, do you connect with people who are interested in community building and helping one another? How do you start that? You start with each other. When being paid for a piece of work, how do you know you aren't being cheated out of the value of work? Which really then says, is this a flawed system? It is. And my favorite one, this was written by a gentleman at Chautauqua Institute who is in, maybe in his 60s or 70s, he's an artist, and he writes, artists must be relevant to their communities beyond their work. Partnerships with collectors, writers, painters, educators are an example. Yes. So on this tour, what do artists want the most? They want validation. Most people, also mostly women, want permission. We don't need permission at all. I don't need any permission. Opportunities. Everybody wants opportunities. And people ask me all the time, what are the keys of sustaining a creative life? So here's a cheat sheet. I always say first, you gotta buy my books. Because to me, it's like artists connecting to other artists. To me, that's about changing a culture. That's what these books are. And actually what the books do too is that it gives back to the venue too and supports me being here. So keep expenses low is the first one. Persistence, apply for everything that fits. Just like that Ford Foundation, Darren connecting to him, that was about a fit. They're interested in creativity and free expression, and so am I, and that's why we fit together. Do the work, do your own research. Even if you get referrals from somebody, don't allow for people to dictate your journey. It's your journey. Everybody in here has a different life in front of them. And then doing the research is not really that hard. I mean, it's actually, when I look for people to be able to collaborate with, not get things from, but actually collaborate with, that's what I mean by that, is connecting with, having a shared experience with. I think about what are the like minds or who am I seeing there in my community, and then inevitably I learn by looking for them who my community is. Share, cultivate, and create your own community. Thinking of the other person first. A lot of times artists just think, okay, they approach someone and say, can you show me? Without even thinking of the other person. I mean, first of all, people don't serve us, they work with us. So thinking of the other person first. I don't believe rejection is personal. It's a difference of opinion. So I've served on enough grand panels to know that very rarely, and in fact, I don't think any grand panels I've been on, that people say, oh, this person's a bad person, so we're not going to give them a grant. It's very, very, it's not personal at all. And I think the more that we embrace that, even though as painful as it is that we don't get things, maybe the universe has a different plan for us that we have to be open to. And then finally, generosity yields generosity. So that's my contact information. The reason why I put that up there is that I'm accessible too. I am 400 emails behind right now. But I always say that if I'm saying hello to you, that if there's a way that we can have a culture of reciprocity, I'm open to that. And I would love now to hear your needs and wants. Thank you so much. That's it. Now it's up to you. So I love silence. We can just sit here
for a while.
And I know everybody puts their eyes down because they don't want to look at me either.
So you want us to talk to you about needs and wants, what we want and need as artists?
Or as people. I mean, that's the same thing, right? Needs and wants, yeah. Can I sit here? It's going to break?
I don't know.
Who knows?
We'll find
out. That'll be a performance. Okay. Yeah. If you can think of, what are your needs and wants, do you think? Everybody has them. I'll tell you what, I'll start, okay? I want more time. Mm-hmm. I just want more time. I want someone to change all the clocks. No, but really, that means I have to do the work to cut some stuff out, right? So that says to me, okay, what do I have to cut out? What are my priorities, right? To have that time. I also want a vacation, which means that I also have to make time, and I love what I do, so I have to force myself and discipline myself to not do these things that run me in the ground. And then the third thing is, I want to collaborate more. So I'm collaborating a lot more for the Sharp. So the Sharp Lenses program, I highly recommend everybody to apply for that. It's very privileged to have that studio. So what I decided to do was have people come in who didn't get that opportunity and draw with me, so they have a sense of feeling of that studio. But also for the Open Studios, which is a big deal. It's the weekend of April 27th, so if you're in town, happy to say hello there and introduce you to people. I'll be there, but I'm collaborating with somebody. So I'm sharing that weekend with another person, taking advantage of opportunity. Okay, those are my three. Now it's your turn. Yes!
I think something for me as an artist I really want is the feeling that I'm allowed to go back and forth on actually being an artist. That I can want to go to grad school for psychology or something else, and also not have to give up the identity of being an artist.
What makes you think, I'm going to write that down, what makes you think that you would be giving it up?
When so I came into school thinking I was going to major in art, but then switch over to psychology. And whenever I've talked about, you know, my options for that with people, I tend to get kind of a duality. There's like one or the other. It's either you're an artist or you're a psychologist. And my parents are psychologists.
Oh.
And my dad went to art school as well, though. And he always kind of talks about, like, he gave it up. And that makes me really sad because I want the opportunity to explore experimental psychology, but also feel like I'm still an artist, even though that's not where I'm making my life.
So, first of all, want to go back and forth. Once an artist, always an artist. That's first. Second of all, we all wear multiple hats, like I was talking about before. I know so many people who are artists who do other things. I don't believe in the term day job at all. Just because you choose to have a job in making money somewhere else doesn't mean you're any less an artist. So I think it's a mentality, and I think you don't have to give it up. There are people I know who, I'm trying to think, in the book, like Brett Wallace in this book, he was hired in part by, because he was an artist, by Reid Hoffman, who's the CEO of LinkedIn, because he's an artist. So
he contributes at LinkedIn in helping startup companies be more creative from an artistic point of view. And inevitably, all those startups have knowledge and work with artists because of him, which is amazing. He works with at least 50 startup companies. Can you imagine if one person for every 50 companies did that who's an artist? And then he has a thriving art career. Same thing. He doesn't, there's no separate thing. And he's 35 years old and going back to getting his MFA at MICA. So that's an answer. You can read that. And you can reach out to him, actually. Everybody in these books are accessible. You can find him on your website, ask that same question to him, and he would be so generous to write you back. Brett Wallace. BrettWallace.com. He also does a conversation project on his website, sort of like a blog of interviews with artists. Okay, that was awesome. Yes?
I've got one kind of along the same spectrum. I want to be taken seriously as a professional because I don't have that day job. Like my entire family, there's a police officer and a teacher and a nurse, and then there's me who's an artist. And I feel like being an artist is not considered a legitimate profession a lot of times.
It is, though. So it isn't, because that's the old world view, mm-hmm. right? But we live in the cracks of society, right? And the way that money doesn't identify necessarily of every profession of success, right? You define what success is. So the old idea, if someone has a 9-to-5 job and they're defined that way, then they're a police officer, right? In that way that you're saying? Yeah, but as an artist, we're defined by a whole other set of rules, right? We're defined by what we make, what we do, how we think. And those are often intangible to the public. But we do contribute not only to the creative economy, but you know what we do the most for society? We contribute to the well-being of others, which is far bigger and far more profound. And if you said to your parents, you know, we contribute to the creative economy, and there's statistics out there that are tremendous. There are a couple of reports that show that there was even one from the Urban Institute, of like a famous one of 10 years ago. But there's also two SNAP studies, S-N-A-A-P. If you just put that in to Google, SNAP study, there's one that came out last year and another one that came out in 2011 that really showed the definition of how artists bleed into society. But the problem is, like today, I can't even say his name of the person who's running the White House. Mm-hmm. I have great disdain for that person. I hate him. Sorry. I'm not sorry. I'm sorry if I offended anybody, but I have great disdain. We can share our opinions as artists too. We ever live in a free society. But he again has tried to pull the NEA off today. He just said we're going to eliminate all of that. So I think right now we owe it to ourselves to say, well, because of like statistics, which some people would believe. But also just examples. That's why I did these books too. These are living, breathing people sustaining their lives as artists. They show their work, they're out in the world, they're contributing to education, all of these places. You know, the problem with the public is so interesting that parents love to ooh and coo about their kids when they're geniuses as artists when they're 3, 4, 5 years old. And then when they get to be 20, they don't want to have anything to do with that, right? There's this huge contradiction. But what if those parents did not have the arts when they were kids into thinking differently? That also artists being like Brett Wallace in corporations, but also there's design thinking, there's many ways that artists contribute in different sectors. It's just not talked about that so much because the value of the arts are down and culture are down in society. But in the 1960s, when the National Endowment for the Arts was started by President Johnson, it was touted as being this huge thing to show our a certain class, a certain culture as being wealth of ideas, but that has changed over the years, and we can get that back. I just got an NEA grant, thank God, I just made it in, because I actually think that we may not have that. And what does that mean for artists? We have to get louder and create more opportunities to capture the value that we already have, to be able to have that and amplify it.
I just have a comment. So I really like, I love that last question, and I like this thing, because it's sort of like, well, what, you know, what do you say to these people who just, they don't see the value that we have or something? And I love the title of the book, Artist as Culture Producer, because it right there, it's sort of like, oh, that's what we do. And then, so I think that that can maybe be a way of languaging, you know, to people outside of that realm.
I agree. I think we all have always been culture producers. We produce culture in this country, and we have been for many years, all of the art forms, in so many ways. I think oftentimes, too, there's an intimidation. This is partially our fault, that artists in the art world, we've limited ourselves to the elite, in a sense, of the white box. Whenever someone isolates themselves from another community, we cut off what we can have. So by being beholden solely to the market, we have strangled ourselves. So we can blame ourselves for that too. So now we have to unravel that, and then we have to show that there are different, there's elastic ways to live as an artist. So for me, I don't make a lot of money doing this tour. You know, I just satisfy all of my, of course, I'm gonna get paid as a sustainable person giving information to artists and following up with artists and my time, because that's sustainable. But I'm not getting rich. I'm most of, 70% of my living comes from these big museum projects, because I take 20% from every project. That's what I make from these projects. The rest is labor to pay other artists, as well as materials and all the expenses that are involved. So that's how I sustain my lives. 30% life, I feel like I have a bunch of lives. 30% of it is teaching, which is like a patchwork. But most artists live in the patchwork of society. Because, and duh, when 2008, the credit crisis came in, people were like, oh, well, artists have been doing gig economy. Of course we have, our lives. So we've always lived in the patchwork and in the cracks of society. It's how we embrace that and show the public how much we do in partnership to and speak their language in order for them to come on board with us. I also think the public has to do a lot of work. It's not just the artists, it's both. Yes, Tim.
I have a question. Or a comment and then a question, I think.
Yeah.
I've had incredible experiences doing community projects
and
being involved in this idea of generosity that you're describing as being so
just
valuable.
Writing it down. Yeah.
And then there's, you know, there's the other side of that where, you know, perhaps studio work where one is alone and developing something, maybe that doesn't have those ingredients of
collaboration.
Generosity and collaboration, but maybe it has these other elements of kind of giving to yourself or kind of looking in and seeing being able to like resolve certain issues that you might have through kind of inquiry. Do you kind of, in terms of like a balance, you know, because I've done community projects and been so exhausted from just putting out and trying to make something happen, you know, and then felt like I needed to run back to the studio to be able to kind of regenerate and at least to just have some time for myself. Do you have any like suggestions or I don't know, like any advice about like balance in that regard? Like,
I'm the worst person to talk about balance, but I think though I understand about balance because I talked about it a lot. First of all, if someone just makes paintings in their studio, which I do too, I make paintings too, and is a shy individual too, and is a loner, which I was for a long time, you can use social media behind a screen to be able to give to other people. Like share somebody else's work on Instagram. It's amazing how many people don't do that. It's ridiculous that they don't. Social media is social. So people who prop themselves and just use Instagram as an extension of their website, I think is awful. So like share somebody else's work on Instagram. Just press the like button on Facebook. You don't have to do much. You don't have to say hi. You know, there are things you can do. Ask somebody what they're doing. Have them over for a studio visit. And by the way, I want to share with everybody, I feel bad because Courtney and I, we had a miscommunication and I have to leave tomorrow. But I'm inviting the graduate students, if you want to contact me to do a Skype studio visit, I'll do it with you. Okay? If you're not afraid of me or hate me from this. But I'm opening the door and I do what I say. It may take me time because I'm on the road, but that's done more often now in when you get out of school. People rarely go to studios now. They just don't have time. So that's also a way for you to learn. If you wanted to learn how to do that, you can use me as a guinea pig too. But anyway, I'm perfectly want to do that with anybody who's interested. So you can send me an email, but tell me who you are, because I get crazy people emailing me every day. So I think that the answer to your question is, I think you find out what your priorities are, what you're good at. I do a lot of community outreach too, and I get exhausted. And like yesterday, I was in my studio with a collaborator, and it gave me so much more life. I think it's just a matter of prioritizing your time. And then at any given time, what's more important to you? Is it more important to do like a studio or an exhibition somewhere versus like a community outreach thing? Like for me, this tour is going to end on May 26th in this country. I have one more stop in the UK in June, but that's it. And then after that, I've designated this time. I think it's more about planning. I'm just going to be in my studio. I'm not going to do this stuff for a while. I'm going back on tour in 2020. So for two books, so that will be enormous. So I gave myself that time, but I think it's balanced. It comes in discipline and time management, and that's the way that I do it. And most people I know who are crazy busy, we do that. But also when I wake up in the morning, my email dictates my day too. It's a balance of both. But everybody's got to find who they are first in order to see what their capacity is, right? In order to see what they can manage. Would you agree with that?
Absolutely.
I think that's hard though for people to realize, because sometimes artists think that they should be living a certain way, and that they don't need to be living that way. They need to be living how they want to live. But it takes time to figure that out, right? Don't you think?
Absolutely.
How long did that take for you to figure out? Well, you probably knew earlier than I did.
I don't know if I have it figured. I think that's why I'm asking.
I finally figured it out. I think the other thing is not caring so much. Like, I just don't care about what people think as much. Like, there's a difference between arrogance and confidence. And so I care what my peers think, but I don't really care about many other people. I can't, because then I'll get crazy and not get any work done. Right? Okay, who's going to tell me? Yes.
Now, going off of that, I was thinking, like, what do I need and want? I feel like some of the things that I need as an artist is to, like, have affirmation. Or actually, I want affirmation without needing it.
Yeah.
One, as, like, a human and as an artist in, you know, the art market. But also when I think about access to critical thinking and artistic perspectives and why it's so important for communities and academics and being a citizen, I would like that to be accessible to people at an earlier age and in a language that's, like, much more relatable and understandable than the way we speak in small college settings.
I agree, completely. Okay, so here are the two things about that. First of all, validation, getting it without asking for it, right? That's human, too. We all need validation. I need validation, you need validation. I think the way that you do that is, first of all, people are not gonna know you're around until you're out there. So you also have a responsibility to put yourself in a position where you can receive that cultural reciprocity. So to be able to be present, first thing. The second thing is, I think, to engage enough in community, and that doesn't mean community projects. Just being present, whether you have a dinner for people or you're going to somebody's event, anything simple that would just be a fabric of your life, having some kind of presence or on social media or what have you. Putting yourself in a position where you can receive that cultural reciprocity. So being around like-minded people who can also give back, choose who your community is, rather than people who are gonna suck everything out of you. I've learned that the hard way. I'm not around takers at all. I can't do it. I'm just not gonna do it. You can spot them a mile away. You can feel them, right? You can feel them. And I just want them to figure it out. And also, narcissists don't know they're narcissistic, right? So I can't fix them. I'm not going to fix them. I'm not going to fix anybody. So I think positioning yourself is really important. The discourse is great, too. What I've learned, too, is, like, I don't know if anybody knows, but forgot to mention this. Anybody here love to write? Does everybody here like to write about other artists, their friends' work, maybe paintings? No? You know? Yeah? Like, just write about it. Like, Sharon Butler, the Two Coats of Paint, always tells me to tell everybody, she pays writers and she is open for you to pitch her. But so is Hyperallergic. So go for it. If you have an idea, see what can happen. There are avenues for that to be published, but also do your, the point is, it's also you can do it for yourself too, for others. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
And Hyperallergic and Two Coats of Paint are not art speak at all. They're not. Do you subscribe to Hyperallergic?
Yes.
So what do you think of it?
I think it's pretty on the nose for pop culture. So.
Yeah. I'll tell him you said that. Well, you can write Rock and tell him.
I will.
And start a conversation with him. He may not write you back because he's so busy, but he's really friendly. Doesn't mean if he doesn't write you back that he's not thinking about you.
Okay.
Seriously. Okay. Needs and wants. Yeah.
I actually have a question.
Yes.
It's a silly question.
It's never silly.
I want a serious answer.
All right.
If the creative process to you is a soup, what sort of soup would it be?
For my soup?
If the creative process was soup, what kind of soup do you want?
Why are you asking that?
I want to see how you answer it.
Why? Well, it's just for me to see physically how I answer it, or the information?
I'm just curious how people would answer something that's just out of the norm in a situation.
It would be minestrone with tons of vegetables and lots of different meat. And it would be hot. What would be your soup? What?
Explain.
What?
Explain.
What do you mean? What would be your soup?
Oh, what would be my soup?
Yes.
The creative process?
Yes. I just answered your question.
I think something thicker than minestrone.
Like, would it be chicken noodle?
No. So like the thicker base than that.
Oh,
so
what would it
like
be?
Tomato.
How do you know minestrone isn't thick?
Oh, well, it's minestrone has a lot in it, but it's just like...
It's fluid.
It's, oh.
And it runs fast. And it has rich tomato that has different spices. Okay, so what's your soup?
I'm trying.
You gotta be able to answer the question that you're asking.
Well, I'm just curious as to like the way that people think of their creative process outside of what their creative process they told themselves it is.
I like a lot of different flavors of things. You know, like, I don't want, like, I mean, boredom is great because it gets you off the couch.
Mm-hmm.
And I think being uncomfortable is the key to making good work. So I always take risk. I try different things. So maybe the minestrone soup would change all the time, and maybe the base would be the same, but I add way different vegetables I never had. Maybe I add some fruit. Okay, you have to come back to me now with the soup. I'm going to give you some time, but...
Oh, okay. I mean, I would probably start with a thick base because I like to focus in. I like to not move far from what I'm working
slow.
On. Yeah, well, slow. I slow down in what I'm working on, what I'm trying to think about. I try not to get myopic with it. I try not to look for too much inspiration once I've got something going. So it has to be a slow thing, something thick like a tomato soup or a tomato base would burn if you just try to do it too fast. Honestly, yeah.
I'm hungry now.
So the idea of, like, there's the soups that you can just cook really fast and they'll go fast and you just toss them on, but
right.
There's the ones that
you can make tomato sauce over 8 hours. You could do that.
Yeah. Yeah, so like that.
I love that. That's awesome. Food is great to metaphor with. Okay, other questions?
I have a non-food-based question. Now I'm
okay, and then I'm going to have you after. Go ahead.
So the rest of you were like starting out and obviously are poor college kids, not even just in the art world, but how do we, other than, you know, appreciating other people's work and sharing and stuff like that, how do we, how can we be generous when we don't have really anything to give?
Write about other people's work. Give them validation. Show up at their events. Ask them what you can do for them. No artist rarely asks other people what they can do for them. What can I do for you? There's a great article, actually, that my husband got to me that, back to, I don't know why I'm thinking about LinkedIn again, but it was Brett Wallace, but Reid Hoffman, who the CEO that I mentioned hired Brett, he had an assistant, now I forget his name. Anyway, I have the article if anybody wants it. I can send it to you to share. And he would get solicitations by people all the time to get Reed's time, right? And he said rarely would people ask Reed, what can I do for you? They would only ask for Reed to do something for them, like artists do. And you know who Reed responded to? Only the people who asked, what can I do for you? Because that's cultural reciprocity. The other day, somebody wrote me. People write me every day. I'm grateful for that. Artists write me every day. I'm so grateful for that. Somebody wrote me and said, I really want your feedback on this work. I say, why do you want my feedback? And she wanted validation. I said, okay, what do you want it on? I had her dig to be specific to talk to me. But then I said to her, it's not really respectful of my time if you're just asking me to assess things and give you validation. What are you going to do for me as a practice? It's not an eye for an eye. There's a difference. It's not an eye for an eye. I'm Sicilian. I know the difference. It's not an eye for an eye. It's more about a breathable conversation. I actually get resentful when artists ask me to give me that validation because you're taking me away from the things in my life by doing that. That's exactly the problem that we all do for ourselves. We do things for free. We allow for that to happen. That brings our value down. That's even our time. We don't respect ourselves enough. So then we're in this white box that's isolated, and no wonder we are not elevated, right? So that's just symbolic. Of course, I called her. We had a 15-minute conversation. I totally was happy to do that. But then I said to her, what are you going to do for other people then? Let's pass on the generosity. And then she wrote me an email with all the things, because the first thing she said was exactly what you said. I don't know what to offer. I think a lot of times we have problems not being able to think these simple things that what we have to offer. I just gave you some simple things. Easy, very easy, natural in a lot of ways. We do it for ourselves all the time and know why we can't apply it to other people. So when I remind her there, she's like, oh my God, yeah, well, yeah. It's sort of obvious, right? Sort of just like being a good person, right? And I made her write it down in an email to me, and now she has it, and she'll be able to pass that on. And then that's going to help another artist, which I think is a good thing to do. Yeah?
In terms of, like, wants and needs, one thing for me is, like, wanting to be able to find or be present with mentors that don't kind of shut you down or in their, like, process, like, invalidate your art or your identity. I've met various mentors in my field that inevitably say microaggressions to me, and it's very hurtful.
Microaggressions?
Yeah.
Yeah, like, that's a problem.
And like, especially when, one, I respect them because they're very successful or they're, like, very well known in this field or whatever, and then you meet them in person or you have a, you know, portfolio review or whatever, and then they not only, like, those microaggressions happen, and even if you try to explain your view, they don't get it. And
right.
So, like, as a person of color and a non-binary artist, like, I focus on a lot of queer issues and, like, things about people of color, and I constantly get questioned by them of, like, you know, why are you doing this? And so, I don't, as a young artist, like, you look to older, like, more established people for feedback and advice, and so I feel like I'm constantly limited by the successful people out there, and I don't know where to find those mentors that are kind of on the same page.
Okay, so first of all, I took an anti-oppression workshop. I advise for everybody to take that in this room. Do they have those here offered for students and faculty? Everybody should have them. Absolutely.
That's interesting.
So, because that's real, what you're talking about.
Yeah.
And for me, as a person who identifies as a woman, it is extremely, for me, before I took that workshop a few years ago, I didn't realize how many microaggressions that I've been suffering from. So I understand. And while I'm not a person of color, I can imagine that. I have compassion for that. And I have friends, most of my friends are people of color, or the people I identify as different genders. So with that in mind, a couple things. First of all, criticism is information. So it's up to us to decipher what the difference is. between that microaggression and criticism as information. So sometimes it can hurt when it's personal, but it may not be a microaggression. That's the first thing. Not excusing those people because there's plenty of microaggressions. Mm-hmm. Just pointing out that criticism and information. Secondly, yes, some people can't see those microaggressions because in this world now, people have to come to be able to the table. They've always been there, but we're in this amazing Me Too environment, finally, that people are being woke, right? They're finally waking up. But I think that the key is for a person of color, and I've learned from many of my friends, and when I do panel discussions, I always have a person of color, for the most part, who is next to me. So taking advantage of that, like I mentioned before. But I think that people of color have to draw in and find them by example, and also in your community. So if you are you talking about mentorships in school, though? That's the thing. Because I hear critique.
In school, but also out of school. So, like, I'm in photojournalism, and so, like, we've had the opportunity to meet, like, professors, or, like, people who come as lecturers or, like, at conferences and things like that. So they're not, like, I've had that with professors, but also with non-professors that are, like, in the world. Like,
so is there a way that you can contribute to making suggestions to your visiting artist program to bring people in?
I mean, it just happens so much. Like,
the reason why I'm saying this is that oftentimes, and as a woman, mm-hmm. I have to be able to make suggestions when I see all white men coming to a school, right? I then have to say to that department, listen, I think you need to change, and these are the people I want to offer. It's not just saying change. It's then offering people, so you may have to do a little work to know who you want to bring in. Mm-hmm. And then how do you know who to bring in, right? You look for sources of places that do inspire you naturally out in the world as far as the visiting artist program. So, like, I keep bringing up Hyperallergic, but Parag Rattini is a person of color, right? Mm-hmm. So he then would be able to speak, and I already know that he does just by me saying this as a close friend. He would be able to come here. So then he would give you that validation. But then even if he gave you those criticisms, it wouldn't be in those microaggressions. Two different things, right? Yeah. But then he would also be able to tell you who else you can lean on. It generally comes from one person and then opens up to another community. As far as your faculty goes, the other thing I would do is a good practice as an artist, no matter who you are, to go back to them and say, and even if you're pointing it out to them and they can't get it, I think you have to say, listen, and I've been now strong enough to say and not caring, worrying, I'm not fearful anymore. And I think that's very hard to do, especially with a person of color of this climate and in different situations. But to be able to say to that faculty, listen, I think you're doing X. And then going to that, if they're not going to hear, you need to go to the other mentors, the other faculty, as much as you can, to bring your voice to them and say, this is an issue. And be drawn to those who are going to give that validation back. Unfortunately, it just takes more of a question of others to be able to find that community. You're probably already doing that. But that right now is, I think, is the best case scenario. Outside, it's also that validation from different places to be able to suggest to come here as visiting artists. But when you get out of school, making an approach to them to see how you can collaborate with them, even from afar. A lot of people think globally. So just as I've mentioned these Skype studio visits, right? People function globally. Even in photojournalism, you can certainly contribute to something from here that's in another place. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
But if you email me and give me a sense of where you're coming from and what your specific needs are for your work, I might be able to make those connections for you as well. Okay? Just tell me who you are. Okay. I had somebody write me from Istanbul, which was really amazing, but they said to me, which was great, they said to me, I understand that you sell artwork. And I was like, no. And then they went on and on about how I should sell their work, what their work should be priced at, didn't do the homework, and it was a weird email too. Like it was very strange, very dictated, very pushy, very odd. anyway, that's what I'm talking about, the oddness of how people assume certain things, perception's really different than reality. I do not sell anybody's work. Anyway, that was funny. Any other, any comments or questions? Use me. Are we going to have some time? Do we have time with people?
Yeah, and we can, you know, while you're signing books, too, we can kind of talk, chat with people.
So does anybody have any other thoughts? You should use me and your tuition. Unless, is it free? Or use your time. Yes.
So I'm a first year author history grad, and you kind of spoke a little bit about your good relationships with certain curators, and I'm just curious what makes
a good
them stand out for you.
It's like, the fit. It's okay. The fit. Like their vision about who they show is going to be, like, if I see who they show and I feel a connection with those artists, I know that they, I want to know, maybe that they may have a connection to my work. Because every curator, dealer, collector, whoever has a specific vision, just like artists. So that's, and then hopefully we get along and the chemistry is really good. It's a whole other ball of wax. I mean, people say too, like a lot of curators and dealers I talk to, if the artist is too difficult, they don't care what the work looks like. At the end of the day, it's a collaboration that flows.
Thank you.
My pleasure.
Thank you, Sharon.
So I'll be here, and I'm available for Skype studio visits if anybody wants them. We have, it's 20 till 7, so I have like time before we go, right?
Mm-hmm.
So anybody, because it's not going to take that long, so if people want to be able to grab me and go places, I'd be happy to do that. Whatever, it's up to Courtney. Okay?
Yeah, sounds good.
Okay, thanks for having
Thank
me,
you.
Everybody. I appreciate it.